serve on the committee, but I've also, either as a punishment or a reward, I'm never quite sure, had the opportunity to be on the tax committee for 7 years. So I served in tax policy for four years in the House, now 3 years on finance in the Senate. So I have that kind of combination of both tax policy and transportation. And so my leader has asked me to stay at the table with them to figure out, if we were going to do this, what is the best tax policy vehicle to use to actually raise this revenue?
Brandenburg has said no to every revenue thing.
Well, and I talked with the leader Grimal last week, mm-hmm. and no to registration increases, no perhaps to sales tax increases. So if those are no's, where are the yeses? Where do you get the money?
Well, I think the answers are, I mean, there are as many creative vehicles for financing anything we want as there are, you know, members of the legislature. You know, everybody's got an idea. And so the question about whether it should be a user-based fee, like a registration fee or a gas tax or a vehicle miles traveled kind of accounting that equates with some kind of revenue raising. There's, frankly, every other kind of an income tax, a sales tax. There's so many different opportunities, I think, for us to look at. And at the end of the day, I feel like not doing something, anything, is not an answer. Our roads and bridges and critical infrastructure need support. So we either have to take that money from somewhere else in the budget and put that into, you know, to beefing up, again, our transportation, our public transit, our roads and bridges, or we're really looking at a pretty critical situation.
Vehicles, go ahead.
Has the governor's like original idea of taxing it at the wholesale level, is that still got legs? Or
I think that's one of the things that probably has the best chance of passing, but it's a very long-term strategy, right? Like it doesn't equate to any huge increase in the short term, at least at the rate that they're talking about, is sort of the parity level. But over time, the wholesale price grows, so we think that revenue stream grows over time. But right now, we're in a position where just to get the majority of our roads up to a good or fair condition from poor condition takes an investment that's bigger than that can provide right now.
Talk to me about the mileage. The more miles you drive, the more you pay.
So this is an interesting one, and it's something that there's just a couple states in the nation right now that are looking at this. But so one of the things you hear a lot in the transportation debate is that just raising the gas tax, which is something we've done for a long time, has had a state gas tax that helped paid for roads and bridges and critical infrastructure. As cars get more fuel efficient, as the national, as Congress has passed requirements that they get more fuel efficient, more people are driving hybrids or electric vehicles, the gas tax is not a long-term sustainable funding.
In fact, it loses money over time.
Over time, it does, right? So the question of what part of the maintenance of the roads should an electric or hybrid vehicle pay, right? So if you're doing it all based on gas tax, they're going to be paying next to nothing or nothing, right? And so the vehicle miles traveled is something that some other states are looking at to say, the wear and tear on roads is the same whether if your car has the same sort of size and weight and everything, whether it's gas or electric, it has the same wear and tear on the roads.
You put a device on the vehicle to determine that number?
You could, but a lot of states are even just doing odometer readings. So every year when you do your registration, fill out your registration, renew your registration, you submit your odometer mileage and you pay
your fee.
Your register.
So it's
your
on
fee.
The honor system.
Yeah, I was going to say.
There's a deal killer.
And there's that.
I drove 20 miles.
That's right. And there's that 3,000 miles I drove on vacation that I don't.
That I don't consider roads. Right. Exactly. You know, right. Yeah, that's a tough one to do. Oregon tried it and they were not totally successful.
Well, and there are very big questions, I think, too, that some folks still have about the, is it too big, brother? If you have something that reads your that reads your odometer, but a lot of folks have said, if you drive a fleet vehicle, if you drive a car that somebody else pays for, you're already, when you do your mileage and you're keeping track of your, a lot of them have scanners and everything, they already know. So it's a balancing
would
question,
you support?
I think. Right now, I sit at those tables and I'm really very open to considering a lot of different ideas. I think depending on the gas tax for a long-term solution is, it's obviously not going to work, and so I would be open to looking at a lot of different solutions.
Including that one?
Including that one. Mm-hmm.
What's your relationship with the governor? When's the last time you talked to him?
When is the last time that I talked to him? That's a good question. Well, you know, he lives in the district that I represent.
Yeah.
And he never did, you know, move up to Lansing. So he's definitely still around. I don't have any kind of, you know, pattern time that I talk with him.
You bump into him a lot down there in Ann Arbor.
Does he know you're from Ann Arbor? Crowds?
Yes, he does. Very much so, yes.
Did you know him before he was elected?
I did know him a little bit before he was elected. Certainly, we're never close or anything. Would never want to characterize it as such. But I knew him, and
well, this will be at least my quote. What is the status of his relationship with individual lawmakers? That pause says it all, doesn't it?
Well, and to be fair, right? Because I always try to. It's one of the things when we were in 2007, when we had a pretty significant budget, hole to resolve. It was one of the criticisms that then Governor Granholm got was that, you know, you have to have relationships with people if you're going to ask them to do heavy lifting with you. And so she had a lot of work to do to get to know legislators. So I think this governor is. He's been pretty hands-off with the legislature. He's allowed other folks to do that work for him. Certainly his lieutenant governor has done a lot of that, especially in the first 2 years of their administration, did a lot of the legislative work. His legislative director, Dick Posthumous, does a lot of that work. The governor himself has come into our caucus twice, like to brief our caucus on an issue twice in the 3 years that he's served.
Does he need to kick it up there a little bit?
I think it would be helpful, and I think right now what you're looking at is, you know, he's put several initiatives sort of in a row out there that were important to him that he had a hard time getting through the legislature, and I think, you know, it's a relationship business. The more that you know people, the easier it is to ask them for, you know,
for
their vote.
Right.
So
you think, in other words, he's vulnerable to the same situation that Granholm had on not having the greatest relationship with the legislature, not in terms of being adversarial, but just not being there, not having that contact.
Well, if you
of course, you're a Democrat,
right?
So you'd have to ask, did Granholm ever go into a Republican caucus? I don't think she ever went into a Republican caucus, did she?
Not that I'm aware of.
But I don't think she ever did.
I don't know if she did or not, but there was certainly a period of time in 07 where she had individual meetings, and I think by time she was done, she had individual meetings with every member of the legislature, Republican and Democrat, and I have friends on both sides of the aisle that would attest that
happened. A lot of people said it was 7 years too late.
Yeah, well she'd been reelected by that time, and she was in her fifth year. I mean, he's still only in his third year.
Right, and I'm not trying to say that no conversations ever happen, but if you look at his sort of major initiatives that they've been trying to work on, starting with the international trade crossing, followed by transportation funding, followed by Medicaid expansion, I think if he had a different relationship with some of those legislators, I think there was either an expectation that folks would follow his lead, and or that they might go along with something that they put out, and people just, you know, didn't.
Well, then he put the billboards in their districts. And what was the buzz on the floor when that started to get around? What were you picking up? I want to hear this, Senator.
Well, I can tell you it was not very popular, and certainly for the ones that, you know, that were called out by name in their district, some of the billboards were a little more generic, you know, tell the Michigan Senate to take action on Medicaid expansion. Some called our colleagues out by name. And, and I think those two things together, if somebody felt like they'd never had a conversation, they'd never been asked directly by the governor for a vote on that issue, and then to have funding supplied by the governor to put a billboard in their district asking constituents to ask them to take that vote felt a little, you know.
Fill in the blank. That's the word I'm looking for. Felt a little.
He's got to write a column.
I do. Come on, help me out. I got to bang out something this weekend here. Felt a little.
Well, I think it felt a little backward, right? Like you're going to ask somebody else. You're going to ask, you know, 285,000 people to tell their senator to do something, or ask their senator to do something that you haven't asked them to do yourself.
Yeah. Is that the problems of a non-career politician? Or just somebody who's arrogant?
Well, it's an interesting thing, right? The voters of this state have adopted term limits, and they've said, although in my personal life I would not want to take my broken car to a mechanic who has 0 years of experience being a mechanic, and I wouldn't want a heart surgeon who's never done heart surgery before, we've got this $51 billion now enterprise that is state government, and we've decided that we want a whole new group of people every couple years to be in charge of that. So, and it creates this situation where experience, where knowledge of the process, where, you know, relationships and connections aren't valued. So, you know, he was able to sell himself as an outsider, as somebody different in the process. But there's a lot of stumbles, I think, that have happened because he doesn't understand the process. And
you mean even with Callie and Posthumus and much more and people like that around him who've been around forever, that's not enough? He still has made rookie mistakes?
Well, I'll say one time, I like Brian Kelly. I respect him. We came in together. We served for 4 years on tax policy during some very tough times in tax policy, right? We were shifting from the single business tax had been repealed. We had to figure something out. We went through the whole Michigan business tax, the surcharge, the sales tax on services, all that together in 4 years. So anything I say about him too positive right now is the liberal of the liberal from Ann Arbor probably doesn't help my friend Brian Kelly in his fight right now. So I don't... But I would say if you look at this administration's successes, you look at the policies that they have literally knocked out of the park, Brian Kelly was the lead.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, he was key. There was no question.
He is, right?
That.
So
yeah.
So when the governor asks Brian Kelly to shepherd something, when he gives him the support to do it, that's when they succeed.
Wow.
Well, do you think he hasn't given Kelly as enough lead responsibility, let's say, on transportation or on some of these other things?
I've never seen Brian Kelly in a transportation conversation at once.
Well, that's not good, right?
Well, if you want success, I'd...
Haven't they kind of been transitioning his role into more like the bureaucracy busters, administrative? It seems like he's been doing less legislatively. Is that your sense?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, he's literally nowhere, man, in the legislature lately. I mean, we don't see. I mean, he still presides, but he's not been active.
He's putting out right wing fires.
First things first, you know. But you have a good working relationship with him.
I have always have. Yeah.
How about over on the other side? Who do you go to on the R side?
On the House side?
No. On the Senate
side.
Besides Caswell.
As well. Well, you know, so I have this interesting designation, right? So I, 7 years in the legislature, 6 years running, I'm voted by you all as the most liberal member of the chamber that I serve in, right? So I'm the left of the left, a standard bearer often for a lot of, certainly for social issues and things like that. But I also have a record of, especially in the last year where not many minority bills passed, of having the highest number of, you know, bills, you know, one of the highest numbers of bills of a minority member signed into law. So I have good working relationships with a lot of my Republican colleagues, and it's based on the idea that I look at every one of my colleagues, and there might be only 10% of issues that we agree on. There might be only 1% of issues we agree on. But on the ones we do, I want to work with them. I want to try to move the state forward. And frankly, I think that's my job. So there's lots of times where I'm not going to agree, and I'm going to stand up and say that I don't agree. But when we can work together, so Tom Casperson and I, you know, he's chair of the Natural Resources, Environment, and Great Lakes Committee. And I chaired that committee in the House for 4 years when I was in the majority. He and I set a totally different agenda. I feel like I am, you know, certainly in opposition to a lot of what he puts forward as chair of that committee. But when we looked at trying to re-energize the Michigan Civilian Conservation Corps to get more young people working in our state parks and natural resource protection organizations and forests and campgrounds and all that, put all the rest of that stuff aside, move forward, got a package of bills, found some support and funding, and got it moved. So that's how I operate.
Yep.
And also the two women, you've got something in common with on some things. What about the wolf hunt? I remember you were, how do you feel about that coming up right now?
You know, I mean, I honestly believe, I mean, there's two things about the way that whole issue went down for me. Like, I think we had a wolf management plan that the DNR put together that, you know, we'd only delisted wolves as a protected species for, you know, 2 years before we decided that we were going to start hunting them again. And we didn't really give the wolf management plan a chance to operate, I feel like. We never gave it a chance. And so So I was concerned about that. But frankly, the way that things went down, when you had a group of you had a group of volunteers that went around the state and collected hundreds of thousands
to circumvent the petition.
And they got it. And that then was the over.
That
over.
Was what? That was.
Well, I think to me that is it is such an affront to democracy, right? Like you have a group of people that went out and worked to collect those signatures. And instead of even waiting until that vote went to the ballot to find out what the people would want to do with that, to say, you know, we're going to circumvent the whole democratic process. And
but they may have an advantage now, because the Wolf people have, you know, obviously they collected signatures.
Who's they?
The Wolf Keep Michigan Wolves Protected.
Oh, you think the Wolf people may now have an advantage?
Well, yeah, because they collected signatures, and then the legislature went around them one way. But
well,
now
they got one on the ballot
already.
Right,
but now they have a chance to get that second one on the ballot, and I'm not sure there's another way to circumvent.
Well, there probably isn't, but the question is, what does that do? What do you think is going to happen with two Wolf proposals on the ballot if they get the second one on? That's weird.
Well,
put on by the same organization.
And frankly, it's a Herculean effort. It is a Herculean effort to go out and get those kind of signatures and to not only have to do it once, but to have to do it twice, largely with volunteers. I mean, there certainly, I think, were some paid petitioners in that first proposal, but it's not like a lot of other campaigns. It was a pretty grassroots campaign. It was a lot of individual people going out with clipboards to the farmers markets and the post office. That's asking a lot to have them do it again.
Let me ask this question. Nobody probably cares about this as much as me, but comparing it to dove hunting.
Sure.
I mean, that's the only other thing we can think of as analogous, but they're so different. Doves, little tweety birds that
doves
everybody loves.
Sympathetic.
Like wolves.
Right, yes.
I'm just not sure that people are going to feel that strongly about protecting wolves, do you think?
Their pictures have been like the baby wolves. They're really cute. I'm just throwing it out there.
But the same group of folks, you know, they want you to be able to pet baby bears up to 90 pounds with, you know, their reach and claws and all that.
That was a little inconsistent with Casper.
It really is an interesting, you know.
Bears are okay, wolves not so much. I was surprised by your hard answer on the lieutenant governor thing. You just see that as a dead-end job?
It's a career-ending dead-end job.
Well, not
it
only
is,
that,
it's a
when your choice is you've got to give up your last term in the Senate to take a flyer, maybe as an underdog candidate for lieutenant governor, if you lose, you're out.
Right.
You don't want to take that chance.
Yeah, I mean, if you're going
to... It's not even that. Honestly, it's not even that. It's just, it's literally... you know, I love the work I do, and because the Senate just having only 38 members instead of 110, you can be relevant and involved in a lot of different issues across the board, all over the state.
What if the party came and said, "Look, we've got polling data that says you play very, very well, and you can help us win."
Oh, I'm sure that is probably true in a lot of ways, right? Like, so there's a lot of polling out there right now that says, you know, when women and African Americans come out and vote, that really changes things for Democrats.
Precisely.
We've gotta motivate women voters, and right now we have a ticket that's, you know, two white men.
Exactly. All right. So if the party appealed to you in that regard, you would still say no.
I would.
You would.
She
wants to get the nomination when John Cherry.
Maybe you
want
to be. Maybe you want to be governor.
I honestly think that is a pretty hard path for somebody like me. I am. I'm a liberal from Ann Arbor.
You're from Ann Arbor.
I'm a liberal from Ann Arbor, but I also, I mean, it's part of who I am, right? Like, I am unyielding in my values. I am not willing to moderate myself to make who I am fit in office. And I've watched friends and colleagues who have done that, and it looks awful. And it's just not who I am. I'm incapable.
Well, yeah, but you're capable of working with a lot of
other
people, as you've just described. You're not Barbara Boxer or something, you know, whatever. So
one of my favorite moments I had the opportunity to do an orientation session with the 12 House members that came in, the class of 12 House members that came in, and it was a bipartisan, you know, it was almost all of them. I think only three of them couldn't make it, so all of them were in a room, and my part of the orientation was the questions that you feel like, you know, you're afraid to ask sometimes, so we shut the door, and it was only newly elected legislators and myself, and it was like where's the ladies' room, where's the ice machine, is there really an ice machine, like all the, like people say you introduce a bill with the LSB, what is this LSB, and how do you find it, and where do you go? And in one of the questions, though, so I'm humbling myself to tell them all the stuff that I learned after having actually already worked in the legislative arena for 13 years before I came to elected office, told them some of the stuff I didn't know and tripped on. And I'm like, okay, so I opened up for questions. Like, what do you want to know? Literally, ask me anything. There's no dumb question. And Tom Leonard, like, raises his hand, and he says, how does this work? Like, I just don't understand. You're literally like the left of the left. You're like the fringe. And most times, the fringe people on either side, you know, there's politic about it, tend to be hard to work with. Nobody can work with them, even in their own party. And he's like, all I hear all the time, though, is like, you're a go-to person. People want to work with you. Explain that to me. And I'm like, how do I explain that to you? I don't. But I think it is just that thing of, and you look at my record, there are no quotes in public that are attributable to me that I don't beat up my colleagues.
I don't go after people.
I talk about values. I talk about a vision for this state. I talk about policy being right or wrong direction, but it's not the people.
So then a Senator Colbeck, who unilaterally stopped the Medicaid expansion thing by not voting, you would not have criticized him for that.
I just don't do that. I don't go after individual people.
You know, it's interesting. He says exactly the same thing. He thinks it's wrong to target anybody, to take them out politically.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So you're maybe simpatico with him.
Well, I actually, you know, I serve on a committee with him, and I keep looking for that space. Like I said, I look for the space where that I can work with somebody. I actually like the way he thinks about issues.
Methodical.
He's methodical. He's linear. He really wants information. We haven't found it yet, that thing that we can work on together. But before we're done, I'm hoping we will. You know.
Beautiful. On that optimistic note, if you'll leave the microphone,
yes,
we'll.
Yes, absolutely.
Quickly. What about the next minority or majority leader? How about you, and what about other candidates in the Senate? What do you think to succeed Whitmer?
Well, I think for me right now, again, if I was focused on running for something like that, I would want to run for majority leader. So all of my time and energy right now that is not directed to taking care of my constituents or working on the legislation that's before me in my committees.
You're trying to get them. Don't just give me a political statement. Seriously, though, who are the people in your caucus who you think are most likely to become the next leader?
I don't know. I guess
are you interested? You're interested. Of course you are.
It's not the time for me to make a statement like that, right?
Well, I understand. So that's the boilerplate language.
Well, you don't have to. It's not an announcement. This is off the record. I'm just curious.
This is literally off the record?
Yeah, no, it's not.
It's never off the record.
The cameras
are on. Tell me afterwards, because it will be off the record with me. Okay, I'll talk to you afterwards.
I'm going to read into that you wouldn't rule it out.